let's start. Okay, Erev Tov, Nashim Yekarot. Good evening, dear women. I'm happy to see you. There was a question here about the rainbow that was seen today. It was big, it was beautiful. People were taking pictures. We'll see the blessing for the rainbow. Today we're going to, you know that this week's parasha is Chayei Sarah. Maybe we'll touch Chayei Sarah a little bit at the end of the lesson or in between the lesson. We are going to concentrate on halachot, on the Jewish laws. We're going to concentrate. I made a booklet of the Jewish laws. You will see it. See, everything is over here. It starts from the morning. What does a person need to do? Birkot HaShachar, the blessings in the morning. Then we have the brachot before we eat, after we eat, and various other brachot, other blessings that we need to say. So Be'ezrat Hashem, we are going to start to go through it one by one. 2 weeks ago, we started with Torah Tziva Lanu Moshe Morasha Kehilat Yaakov. And then we spoke about V'dibart Abam. Now you will find it in the book because Simcha's daughter Leah translated what I wrote to English. So you have the English version too in front of you. So you'll see at the beginning, you see the Torah that Moshe commanded us is the heritage and congregation of Yaakov. And I told you that Morasha means it's more than a person receives something. When a person dies, he leaves everything, all his possessions to the other person. Morasha is a thing that we cannot give anyone else and we have to keep. Because the Morasha that we receive from Moshe Rabbeinu, from Hashem, is Torah and Eretz Israel and the land of Israel. And you know that even the land we cannot give away. It's not ours to give away. It's Morasha, not Yerusha. Not Yerusha, the Morasha. And what is Morasha? This is a chidush I'm going to give you now. It's more than that. Morasha is Rasham Vav Hei. Tistaklu, Reishin Mem, which means he wrote, he completed. Rasham, Shamal, Kep. Vav Hei, the name of God. I'll write it as Kuf over here, but it's the name of God. And it means, you know, Parashat Beshalach, when God speaks about Amalek, he said, Kiyad al Kesiyah milchama la'Hashem be'Amalek midor dor. Which means God said, as long as Amalek is in this world, I have to fight Amalek, and my name is not completed. It's only half of it. So the name of Yudkei. Vav K is only Yud K, only Yah. And Vav K is not completed with a name. Kiyad al Kes Yah, Yah, only Yud K. And that's why we have Morasha, we complete the name of God. And the Morasha is the Torah and the land of Israel. Every leader that gave part of the land of Israel, something bad happened to him. There wasn't a leader that gave parts of the land of Israel and nothing happened to him. There wasn't something like that. Because we are not, it's not ours. The creator of this world, that created the whole world, decided that the land of Israel is going to be for the children of Israel. Period. No question mark. Nobody has to ask anything. This is what's written from the one who created the world. He's the boss of the world. And he said that land of Israel belongs to the children of Israel. Ishmael, the Muslims cannot ask for properties in the land of Israel and parts. Why? Because Avraham Avinu, while he was alive, he divided his possessions between his children, Yitzchak and Ishmael. Ishmael are the Muslims are the descendants of Ishmael. That's why on the age of 13, they do Brit Milah circumcision. They circumcise themselves on the age of 13. Because they are the descendants of Ishmael. And what did Avraham Avinu do? And it's written in the Torah. He gave presents to the children of Ishmael, to Ishmael. And he gave all the Morasha, the Torah and the land of Israel that was promised to him by Hashem, to Yitzchak. So and there's no question mark about who the land of Israel does belong to the children of Israel or doesn't belong. It's a fact, Zovda, that the land of Israel belongs to the children of Israel by the Torah.
Okay.
By the Torah.
It
doesn't, this is the time of Mashiach. Everybody knows that. Eben Ashtia, listen very carefully. That, you know, the world started to be created from Eben Ashtia. Eben Ashtia, it's the rock of water, of drinking, it's called. The rock of drinking, Eben Ashtia, is an underneath Harabait. Underneath our Harabait, Eben Ashtia, that's what the Zohar Kadosh says, Eben Ashtia is there. But Be'ezrat Hashem, because we are in the period of times of Mashiach, Shemimena Nivra Olam, Shehakadosh Baruch Hu Mitachat La'Harabait. And it says, because those are the times of Mashiach, and we can see that everywhere. We can see that what is written in the Gemara and in the Zohar Kadosh, and everywhere, it's written that in the times of Mashiach, all the lies will be considered as truth, and all the truth will be considered as lies. Even though the truth is in front of our eyes, if you look even on the TV, in the internet, even when they give reports about Israel, you'll see everything is upside down. Everything is not correct. Nothing is true. Everything is miscorrected. Everything you see on the TV and also in the news and also on the newspapers, you can see it's shocking to see how the truth is covered. And more than that, it says that also the prices in the land of Israel, the prices of the houses will be very high, and the prices in all the world will go down. Exactly what's happening now. It's like, you know, the prices to buy a building in Israel or a house in Israel is so high today, you can't buy even a house there. Because you have to have a lot of money to buy a house. But over here in the United States and all over the world, all the prices go down. Everything that is written. Pnei adog kipnei kelev katub. It says that the face of the generation will be like the face of a dog. And it's tartei mashma. In both ways, you'll see dogs and cats inherit money, inherit possessions. You'll see it happens today. It's tartei mashma, even literally, it's true today. It means when you say that the face of the generation is like the face of a dog, it means that they have chutzpah. That they have chutzpah. They don't believe in Hashem. They do whatever they think because the Yetzer Hara, the evil spirit, rules right now. So you can see everything that is written exactly one by one. It's truly over here. It's truly happening. So we are truly in the times of Mashiach.
6 years ago, Rav Pinto says, where all the real estate was running up here, he says very soon the real estate will fall down here and Israeli real estate will start going up. It's a time to buy real estate in Israel. 7 years ago, he said that.
And he who has money should buy land in the land of Israel. It's very important, a house, a flat, something that you will have in the land of Israel. And I would like to tell you another thing. So you see about Morasha, but I wanted to comment about the keshet. You saw the keshet. You know why we see such a beautiful keshet? And you are not allowed to look so much at the keshet. But you know the rainbow. Slicha, keshet is rainbow. Rainbow. Slicha, keshet is rainbow. Okay? So I would like to tell you something. We just, a few weeks ago, we spoke about Parashat Noach. And Noach, God showed him the keshet. The rainbow, and he said, you see, I'm showing you, this is a treaty between me and all the universe, that I'm not going to destroy the universe with water. And I would like to tell you something. You know, I'll explain why he destroyed it with water, because I want to go to the halachot, the Jewish laws, to go through it. But the keshet, when we see that, it's in order, the rainbow, when we see the rainbow, it's in order to remind us three things, very important. One is jealousy, kuf is kina. The kuf of the keshet is kina, jealousy. Shin is sina. Sina, which is equal to kavod. When a person is looking for honor, he wants people to honor him. And when they do not honor him, he hates them. So shin is sina. And taf is ta'ava, lust. Ta'ava. That's the taf. When you see a keshet, God reminds us, I ruined the world once because of that. Because of jealousy, hatred, lust. That's when you see a keshet. God reminds us. Buchaba, tahtava, tava, lust. Lust, when a desire to have things that do not belong to you, like money, like women, men that do not belong to you. Zetava, lust. Okay? So when you see a keshet, it's God calling us, reminding us, ringing the bell to tell us. Dear children, don't forget, I'm showing it to you because this is what's happening now in the world. And wake up and do a fixing to yourselves before I do something. It's like a warning, a bell that it rings. That's why you saw the keshet so beautifully. Because when it comes, it reminds us that God is very angry. He does not ruin the world with water, even though there was, I think in Indonesia, there was a tsunami again. Just right. God reminds us. You see the rainbow? It's to remind us. Go away from your evil ways. Come back to me. Remember that I am the ruler of this universe. You shouldn't be feeling that you are heroes in this world. You stay here for 70 years, King David says, 70 years or 80 years.
Please don't talk.
They're explaining each other in Russian. I understand sometimes, I don't understand. Yes, so let's, if you don't understand something, tell us. We'll wait a few minutes, we'll explain it again, okay? So it's very important to know that this is a bell that rings to remind us, do tshuva, all of us. Not only the children of Israel, but the whole world. But mostly the children of Israel. Because the children of Israel helped Hashem create the world, renew the world every day. By studying Torah, I told you about V'dibarta Bam, by studying Torah, and by studying the oral Torah, the written Torah and the oral Torah, and by doing His commandments in this world, and by practicing unconditional love to each other. So this is very important. And I would like to tell you, you will open this, you will open the booklet and you will see that we have kan V'dibarta Bam, and I told you when we spoke about V'dibarta Bam over here, that when we say in Shema Yisrael V'dibarta Bam, it means that we are going to speak about the written Torah, which starts with the letter Bet, because it starts Bereshit Bara Elokim, in the beginning Hashem created. And then the oral Torah, Mishnah, starts with the letter Mem, and it's written over here, Meimatai Korin Shema Shel Arbit. You have it in the booklet, which means over here it says, when do we start to say Shema at night? So V'dibarta Bam, the Bet is for the written Torah, and Mem is for the oral Torah. And let's continue. It's written Kacha, Ketub Be'avot Aleph, it's written in Avot, B'Mishnah, that lo midrash ikar ela maaseh, not study but practice is the main thing, which means gadol limud Torah shemavil lidei maaseh, which means when we study Torah it causes us to do the commandments. If we don't study, we don't know anything. Like we didn't know about the challah. We studied how to prepare challah and how to do hafrashat challah. So now we know, we can do it, practice it at home. But when we do not know, so we do not know who we are, we do not know our essence. Because every Jewish person, I told you, the whole children of Israel are and all the nations are the children of Hashem. Kulam, everybody was born Betzelem Elokim. Okay? Everybody has part of Hashem inside him. All of the children, all over the world. The difference between the nations and the children of Israel, God gave us more parts of the soul than others, the other nations. Why? So we can study and learn the Torah and understand it, the written and the oral Torah. Now, what happens when a person does not practice Judaism? He does not know Judaism. This ability, this essence is still inside him. It's like a seed that you take of an apple tree. All the genetics that he has to have in order to create an apple tree out of it is in that small seed. But if you won't plant it in the ground and water it and feed it, it won't grow as an apple tree. So the Jewish nation, everybody, if we do not know, we still have the ability. Once Hashem brings someone to wake us up, it doesn't matter who it is, someone like this wakes us up, then we have the ability, we can practice Judaism. We have those parts of the soul that we need in order to understand Judaism. It's a privilege to be a Jew. It's a goy that is converting to Judaism at that moment when he converted, and he did really Orthodox conversion. At that moment that he did the conversion, God gives him, because like he's a child that was just now born. So God adds to him the parts of the soul that every Jew is born with. Do you understand? That's the difference. So we should respect human beings, Ken.
זה
מורשה, אז חילקתי את זה לשמר ואב קי, אנחנו משלימים, המורשה זה להשלים את השם של השם. כי יד על כסייה, זאת אומרת שהשם של השם לא שלם כשנמצא המלאק. אז בכדי להשלים את השם של השם, הקדוש ברוך הוא נתן לנו מורשה, תורה בארץ ישראל.
אבל זה משפט?
זה חלק ממורשה, אני פשוט סידרת לכם את האותיות אחרת. זה רשם תורת מורשה, שמר בבקי, ורשם בבקי. להשלים את שם השם בעולם הזה, in this world. Once we complete the name of God in this world, we cause that the Shekhinah will be around us and we cause good things to ourselves and to all the world, not only to ourselves. For example, I already taught you that when we do tzedakah, we complete the name of God. Two people do tzedakah, they complete the name of God. Why? Because the koyin is considered the yud of the name of God, from yud kei vav kei, the yud. And the thought is the yud. And then when I open my hand to give the tzedakah, to give the money, to give the food, to give clothing, everything that I give, to give something from me, I open my hand, is five fingers. Five fingers in numerical value is hey. So this is the hey, the first hey of Hashem. It's the, we have already yud and hey. Then I open my hand towards you, I open my hand. So this is the vav of Hashem. And she opens her hand, another hey, another five fingers, I completed the name of God by giving tzedakah. You know, everything that we do, we are completing the name of God, which is already in this world, we complete it. אני נתתי כסף לצדקה, שמתי, ומישהו אחר לקח, זה כבר יד. היי והי, נגמר. יש לכם, because this is the hey. The hand is very important, because the hand, I already told you, has 14 parts. Look, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. 14 parts. 14 parts the Yudalid. It's called Yudalid. Yudalid. This is 14. Another hand is another Yudalid. Another 14. This is 28. You know what Yudalid and Yudalid together is? Yadid, Chaber, a friend. A friend. Yudalid and Yudalid, friend. Friends, when we love each other unconditionally, this is power. Because Yad, Vod, Yad, look, 14 and 14, hand in hand, gives us 28. 28 in the numerical value is Koach, power. Mm-hmm. Once we love each other unconditionally, it's power. It's more than that. We have in our hands, it's very important. We have Birkat HaKohanim in our hands. Birkat, it has a lot of secrets with the hands. I'm just giving you another thing of the hand that will continue. We have in our hands Birkat HaKohanim. Yevarkecha Hashem v'yishmerecha. Ya'er Hashem panav elecha v'yichuneka. Yisa Hashem panav elecha v'yasem lecha shalom. The whole hand. Shalom, peace. We have Birkat HaKohanim in our hands. You understand? So that's why usually we take our father and mother's hands when they come from shul and we kiss them. That's the minhag, because we have Birkat HaKohanim. They came and they put their hands on our heads because this is Birkat HaKohanim. And this, all of the hands is shalom. Look how beautiful it is. Everything comes, combines together. So let's continue. I'm giving you the introduction in order that we will be on the same page. We will understand Judaism a little bit and we'll go into laws. And now let's continue. Look at your booklets. And it's written, היהדות קבע, I wrote over here, היהדות קבע שלושה מקורות שהפכו להיות אבן יסוד לאלפי הלכות. And three things, three sentences, שלוש מקורות, three sentences. The first page, everything is in the first page. In Judaism, three verses were established. It's the first page. You see that? Everybody's on the...
Yes.
Yes? Everybody sees? Okay. בעברית זה פה, הנה, כאן. פה. כאן. זה חלק השני. And you will see the phrases that there are two תמידים. I always say, we have to remember, חזל אומרים, two תמידים. Two things that we have to remember them for always. Every time in front of you, say that. One of them, both of them are from Tehillim. The other one, I didn't try it here. I'm going to write it on the board. Add it to your booklet. Okay? One of them is this. It's the first one. Shiviti Hashem Elegdi Tamid. It's written Shiviti Hashem Lenegdi Tamid. I made those booklets for you women and for the ones in Brooklyn, because I know it's hard to go through Shulchan Aruch. So I prepared things for us, and I wrote introductions to things so you'll understand. So our knowledge will be approximately the same. So one of them is Shibiti Hashem and Edita Mid. It's chapter Tet Zayin in Tehillim. And then Bechatati Lenegdi Tamid. Can add the second one, the Negdi Tamid. That's from chapter Nun Aleph. This is 51 in Tehillim, and this is 16 in Tehillim. Okay? In Tehillim. Shibiti Hashem Negdi Tamid, which means I see Hashem in front of me. I have placed Hashem before me constantly, always. I put Hashem, you know, Shibiti Hashem Negdi Tamid. If you look at the Rashi Tevot of Shibiti Hashem and Bitamid is Shin, the first letters of each word. Over here it's Yud, okay, I'll write here Yud. And then over here is Lamed, and over here it's Taf. If you add them together, it's a Shilat. You know who was Shilat? Shmuel Bar Shilat, you know who he was? Shmuel Bar Shilat was a descendant of Haman HaRasha. You remember I told you about Haman HaRasha had a descendant. You remember that I told you that Shaul HaMelech, King Shaul, did not kill the king of Amalek, Agag, because he saw that in the future there's a big rabbi that will go out, a big rabbi's soul that is captured in the souls that he has. And that rabbi was Shmuel Bar Shilat. Shmuel Bar Shilat. And that's why he did not kill him, because he was very righteous, King Shaul. And he did not kill him because he knew that in the future, Shmuel Bar Shilat is supposed to, he was a big rabbi. It says that he used to teach, Tinokot Shel Bet Rabban, small children Torah. He did not see his backyard for 15 years. He did not go out of his house. Why? Because he remembered from whom he came from. And he wanted Hashem to love him and to forgive for all of the sins that they made in the past. So he did not go out of his house. It's a big mitzvah to teach small children. And he told them for 15 years he did not even see. The Midrash says, the Gemara says, that he did not see his backyard. Why was he called Shilat? Because in order not to fall into the hands of the evil spirit, Baruch Haba, welcome. I'm so happy to see all of you. In order not to fall up. You have to give them booklets. Who came now and doesn't have a booklet? I'll give you one. And I'll give her one in English, but it's not stapled. And she needs also in English? It's Richa, it's Richa Bangli? Ivri?
Yes,
sir. So listen, dear women. So he used to see in front of his eyes the name of God. Yudke Vavke. He used to picture it in front of him, so he won't do a bad thing. Listen very carefully. So what did he do? He looked at the sentence from King David and he said, Shiviti Hashem lenegdi tamid. I see the name of God in front of me always. So if a person sees the name of God in front of him always, he won't fall down with the evil spirit, because he will remember that God is protecting him, and he wouldn't choose to do bad things. And then you have the Chatatine Lenegdi Tamid, and my sin is in front of me, Livriut, always, which means I am aware that I can sin, but it's in front of me so I can choose to do the right thing and not the bad thing. So those two Tmidim, those two constantly or always, are the two things that you should remember always in front of you. You should study it by heart. Always say that sentences, because by saying the Hebrew sentences, the Hebrew letters, you are bringing angels to protect you from choosing bad ways.
Is this parrot, or it could be anything?
No, it's not those two sentences from the parrot. Atopasuk is a sentence. The verse is from the parrot. This one, Shibiti Hashem Negdi Tamid. This one, and the second one, ma? Yeah, that's what I said. Write the second one. I didn't put it in the book.
Can you give me the translation?
Sure. Yes, and my sin, I wrote it. My sin is before me always. My sin is here. It's my sin is before me always. That's the second. And the first one you have translated in the English version. This is the second one. My sin is before me always. To remind yourselves, to remember it in your mind. Okay? That's what King David said. In order to do tshuva in front of Hashem. I'm giving you the essence and the building blocks of Judaism. I want to explain things to you before, so you'll understand why we do those halachot. Why do we do those, everything that we do in the Jewish laws? Why do we need to do netilat yadayim? What's behind it? So I'll explain it to you so you'll understand the essence of everything. Okay?
What means the first word?
You have it in the booklet. The first sentence, just add it to the... I have placed Hashem before me constantly, or always, okay? This is the first sentence. And now you know also, why he was called Bar Shilat, because he used to say this sentence to see it in front of his eyes. That's why he was called Bar Shilat, because this is the Rashi Tevot. When you see, you'll know now. You'll be Talmidei Chachamim. Wow. You'll know that. He is called because of this sentence of King David. So let's continue. The second phrase is Hikon Likrat Elokecha Israel, which means the children of Israel. You should be aware in order, and you should be excited in order to meet Hashem. This is the time of Mashiach. We should be ready. It says about the Chafetz Chaim that everywhere he went, he used to have a bag with him. And his Hasidim were afraid to ask what was in that bag. And once he passed away, to Istalek Ma'olam, it says that they opened the bag. And you know what they found inside? Bigdei Shabbat, a clothing of Shabbat, new ones, cleaned ones. He was ready to meet Mashiach. He said, whenever Mashiach comes, I have clean clothing with me. New ones that I can dress up and meet Mashiach. You know, so we should also, it says, Hikon likrat Elokecha Israel, we should be ready in order to meet Hashem. And once we meet Hashem, you know, God forbid, if Mashiach comes with judgment, there will be so much fear in the world, there won't be any time for tshuva because of the fear. That's why now is the time to do tshuva. Now is the time to learn Judaism. Now it's the time to practice what Hashem wants us to do in this world. Anyway, we do not stay for a long time. This is all only a posdol. Corridor. Anyway, and then we go away from here. Only the soul is forever. The soul that is captured in this body, she sees from the starting of the world till the end of the world, from the beginning till end, because the soul is endless. The soul is not limited. It's just limited because of the body in space and time. But otherwise, there aren't any borders for the soul. So she's a guest in this body, and then she goes out. But when she stands in front of Hashem, she cannot say, well, my friends did this, and the other friend, it does not matter. God will ask her, why didn't you do what you had to do in this world? You came into this world, you had to do what I commanded you to do. Why did you choose to do differently? So nobody can use anyone. A person stands in front of Hashem alone. The soul stands alone in front of Hashem. With all of the beauty of the clothing, of the commandments that she fulfilled, and the good deeds that she fulfilled. This is the beauty of her clothing. And God forbid also the bad things that stay. And I hope we won't have a lot of bad things. Everything will stay away, nothing. So we see the second sentence is Ikon likrat Elokecha Hashem, wait for Hashem, Israel, the children of Israel. And then Brechol drachecha Deu, it says know him in all your ways. This is why we learn all of the Jewish laws, because Brechol drachecha Deu, it's over here, it's in the first page. In all your ways know Hashem. So which means everything that we do, when we wake up in the morning, we should remember Hashem and we should bless Hashem. We're going to speak about it. And then when we go to eat, we should bless Hashem. And when we wear a new clothing, we should bless Hashem. Everything that we do should be with a blessing toward Hashem. Everything that we do in the Reshut, we eat, we sleep, we are intimate with our husbands. Everything we do, everything is connected to Hashem. Why? Because even when you are intimate with your husbands, and you want to get pregnant, dear women, the soul comes from Hashem. It depends on your thoughts, what kind of soul will come to your child. You know, if you go to the mikveh and you go back home and you were purified for your husband, and the only thought that you blessed and you said, God, please give me a righteous boy, a righteous daughter, and then your husband thinks the same thing, and then God sends the soul from a very high place. Everything depends, starts with the mind. Everything. Because all our deeds, I have three things. When we do a deed, it starts with a thinking, machshava, then dibur, and then maaseh, which means, just a minute, I'm talking and then I'm writing in Hebrew, and I'm speaking in English. And then maaseh, it starts with a thought, then you start talking about it, and then it goes to action. You act after you said something, then you act and do something. And when you think about if you're happy and you think about good things in your mind, then everything that goes out of your mouth, you take margaliot, like flowers go out of your mind, good things go out of your mouth. Sorry. And then you do good deeds. It gives you a good energy to do the good things. But if you have a bad thought and you took it out of your mouth, your actions will also be the same thing. And then what do? You cause Hashem, that is part of you, to do bad things with you. You took the energy of life that God gave you, and you force it to go and do bad things with you. So these are the three parts of thinking until going to action, to do and doing things. So everything, that's why you have to do b'chol drachecha deu, which means everything you do, you have to know Hashem. You have to practice the Jewish law with everything that you do in this life. And then we go, I wrote to you, we have Torah Shebichtav. Oral Torah is divided to 24 books. And it's divided to three. It's Torah, which means the Chumashim, Bereshit, Shmot, Vayikra, Bamidbar, Dvarim. Those are the five books. Then we have Nevim, the prophets. And then we have Ktuvim, the writing. Ktuvim is Tehilim, Mishlei, Kohelet. You see, Ezra ben Nechemiah, Dibrei Hayamim, that's the last. Together it's 24 books. This is the written Torah. I want you to know that. Then we have the Torah Shebe'al Peh, the oral Torah. Before the ruining of the Second Temple, there wasn't any writing of the oral Torah. The oral Torah, look how wise the children of Israel were. The oral Torah went from mouth to ear. They knew that from mouth to ear. They remembered that. It was not written. But after the ruining of the Second Temple, our Chazal, the sages, were afraid that the oral Torah would be forgotten. They started to write the Mishnah, Shishana Sidrei Mishnah. You see, I wrote it over here. I'm just speaking, but you'll find it. They started to write the Mishnah, the Gemara, Talmud Bavli, then Talmud Yerushalmi. Everything was started to be written. כן, זה בדף הראשון, פה. תורה שבעל פה זה החלק האחרון. תסתכלי. תראי לתקה. So you can see that the oral Torah was started to be written. Even Sefer Yetzira, the book of creation, which was considered that Abraham Avinu wrote it. It's the book of creation was written, when we'll continue with the letters, I will speak about the book of creation, was written in a short way that regular people do not understand. You will read it, but you will not understand. But the ones that do understand, those are very holy and righteous people, can create things in this world. It's like Rabba Bara Geber. It's written in Masechet Sanhedrin, Shebara Bara Geber, Rabba Bara Geber, which means he created a human being, just without a soul, by using the Hebrew letters. But those are secrets that were in Sefer Yetzirah. More than that, the brothers of Yosef, you remember that they were eating, and he went to his father, and he said that they are eating parts of an animal when the animal is still alive. And it was not true, and Yaakov did not answer him back. You do not see that in the book. You do not see that because they used the book of Yetzirah that they already studied from Avraham Avinu. They used the Hebrew language, the holy language, and they created an animal in order, kosher animal, in order to eat her. So then they did not use to do the shechita and everything, because this is a creation of what they said. There are more examples of that in the Gemara, of all of those things. Those are very high things that only very, very righteous people can have. And today, this goes from mouth to ear. Only very special people know the secrets of those things. It's not for the common people. It's not for us. It's only for people that really, really are righteous. But I want you to know what kind of precious things and diamonds our Torah has. It's precious things. So there's a very big power to the Hebrew language, to the holy language. Then go to the second page, okay, in the booklet, and also in the English booklet. I feel warm. I thought
it's
that
very hot.
It's very hot.
Yeah, it is hot.
I thought that it's only me. Okay, let's continue. Then we see mitzvot d'oraita. We have the mitzvot, the commandments from the Torah, and the commandments from the Torah are 613. Okay, we received 613 d'oraita. D'oraita, the commandments from the Torah, 613. They are divided to 248 and 365. They are divided. Matayma aseh, commandments that you should do, velotas, and you should, 365 that you should not do, lotaseh. Those are the commandments from the Torah, the written Torah, the Oraita. Then we have seven commandments, the Rabbanan, which come from rabbinical commandments. Look at them over here. We have the first one, it's mitzvat ha-ne'enim. The first one is the mitzvah, the commandments that we take pleasure of. Do you see them in the booklets?
Yeah.
The second one is Netilat Yadayim. The Netilat Yadayim, which we're going to speak about soon. Then the third one is Ladlik Ner Shabbat, to light the candles of Shabbat. This is the Rabbanan. The first one is the Mitzvat HaNe'enim. The things that we bless and do when we take pleasure of, before we eat, when we smell things.
Why are these seven separated out from the 600?
Because this is our rabbis that added it. Okay, our sages that are, they are part, they are part of the Oraita, because the Torah Shebe'al Peh, the oral Torah, is also by the sages. God gave everything to Moshe Rabbeinu, but the sages started speaking about it, and they wrote, you know, all the Gemara that you see is only about a few sentences. The whole Gemara is about a few sentences from the Torah. You won't believe it. It's a few sentences and so many explanations and so many things that are connected to it. But it's only a few sentences. It's based on a few sentences from the Torah. It's like when I gave you two lessons ago, the only Torah Tzeva Lanu Moshe Marasha Kilat Yaakov. I gave a whole lesson only about one sentence. You remember? So you understand, it's like an ocean. It's endless. So we see that we have, let's continue, we have also lighting the candle of Shabbat, then we have Iruvin. You remember Iruvin?
Yes.
That we have Tavshilin, we have Iruv Tavshilin, we have Iruvin. How much are you allowed to carry on Shabbat if you have Iruv, you do not have Iruv?
It's these seven mitzvot.
That's seven mitzvot, the Rabbanan. Yeah, wait, I'll explain. Yes, I'll explain everything. Let me just go through it. And then you have Kriyat Halel, that our sages says. You have to say Halel on Rosh Chodesh, on Chanukah. We say Halel on holidays, on Rosh Chodesh. This is Halel. This is from our sages. Then we have Ner Chanukah, the lighting of the candle of Chanukah. We have hints. Continue. See that? That's the sixth one. We have hints. We have hints in the written Torah about Chanukah, but the lighting book, but our sages told us to light a candle of Chanukah. Then we have Kriyat HaMegillah. We have Megillah, the Megillot. We have five Megillot in the written Torah. Five Megillot. And each one of them we read in a different holiday. I'll write it over here. Don't worry, in a few minutes I'll explain it. I just want you to note that you'll be knowledgeable in the Torah and you'll understand. We have seven mitzvot, the Rabbanan, and 613 mitzvot, the Oraita. So we see the Megillot. So we have Megillat Esther. Megillat Esther we read in Purim. Okay? Then we have Megillat Eicha. Eicha we read in Tisha Be'av, Tet Be'av. Then we have Shir HaShirim. Shir HaShirim we read on Pesach. Then we have Ruth, Ken Shavuot. Then we have Ruth. This is on Shavuot. And the fifth Megillah that we have is Kohelet. And this is on Sukkot. Okay? So those are the five Megillot. I didn't write it, copy it. I'm just giving you, I'm adding things to it, add it to your booklet, so you'll have the basic knowledge of Judaism. So you see the five Megillot that we read them, this is also the Rabbanan. It comes from our sages.
I don't see Kohelet, it's
here,
but I don't see
it. No, Kohelet, Sukkot. Okay? On Sukkot. So we have five Megillot that the Rabbanan. So now we know we have Sheva Mitzvot. Ken. Esther Bepurim. And then we have Eicha Betisha Be'av. Tisha Be'av we read Eicha. And then we have Shir HaShirim we read on Pesach. And then we have Ruth, Megillat Ruth, we read it on Shavuot. Then we have Megillat Kohelet, and we read it on Sukkot. Ken.
No, women also
Okay, I would like to tell you, dear women, let's continue. Let's concentrate. I hope now it will be. אני מרגישה מתבשלת. אני מרגישה לאט לאט, אבל זה טוב, אנחנו נהיה רזות. תודה. How are you? I'm happy to see you. Write it down, add things to your booklet. Okay.
If somebody is coming home, we can read the Hallel.
בטח, בטח. רק לא להגיד את הברכה. נשים לא אומרות את הברכה שלפני הלל ובסוף. You do not say the ברכה, the women. They can say, because all the songs are from Tehillim. But you are not allowed to say the ברכה at the beginning of the end, because you are women. Okay, dear women, let's continue. ברוך אתה מן החלום שהכל נהיה בברכה. אמן. Okay, dear women, let's continue. Now I told you, we went through the seven commandments from our sages, and I told you there are 16 and 30 commandments from the Oraita. The Oraita, and over here plus seven the Rabbanan, we receive 620 commandments. Now listen, you know what 620 commandments are? Look how beautiful it is. It's the crown of Hashem, Keter. Because Chaf is 20, Taf is 40, numerical value, and Resh is 200. Together it's 620. That's the measure of Keter. Keter is over here. You know there are 10 measures that God created. We have 10, and we are divided to those 10. The first three ones is Keter, the crown, Chochmah veBinah, wisdom and understanding. So this is the Keter. This is like under the throne of Hashem. All of these are connected to the Keter. When God says, Manchil lo ava yesh, I'm going to give my loved ones, the ones who truly practice the Torah, who truly, they didn't do Judaism in order to disguise themselves, just to be social with other people, but truly in their hearts, because HaKadosh Baruch Hu, He seeks our hearts. He knows what we do. If it's true or it's not true. So he says, God, for those that I love, the ones that are truly righteous in their hearts, not only from the outside, but in the inside they are righteous, I'm going to give them Yesh. Yesh Begimatria, Yud is 10, and Shin is 300. Numerical value together, it's 310, exactly half of 620. Because the ones that support, Bruchot Abaot, Yishar Koach, the ones that support the Torah, give money for yeshiva, for the yeshiva, dear women. So we can see Baruch Hashem.
Iris, מה קרה לה?
Yeah, out of Spain.
What's the word?
Yes. Manchil lo ava yesh. This is the pasuk. It says manchil le ohavai yesh. So God says, like Zvulun and Issachar. Zvulun was younger than Issachar, but God, everybody reminds him before they mention Issachar. Issachar was a very high scholar. He knew the Torah, he was very wise. Zvulun was the one that went working. Shochen al Chof Yam. He went, he had ships, he worked, and he gave money to Issachar so he can sit down and study the Torah. So God says, look how beautiful this combination between people who do not sit all the time and study Torah, but just make time for themselves every day to study for an hour, for example, Torah, and the ones that study the whole day Torah, God divides those 620 mitzvot, commandments, between both of them. When they go, they receive the one that Pirnes gave income to the students that study Torah. And the ones that study Torah, he divides between them all the mitzvot, all this beautiful clothing that they receive because they study Torah is divided between both of them. That's why he says, Manchilo Abayesh. Why is it Abay? Because when people love each other and give from themselves, even though, let us say, a person is a merchant, for example, Usocher, he's a merchant, and he works all day, and only at night he goes to Shiur Torah. But meanwhile, he takes from his money and gives it out to yeshiva, to scholars who truly study Torah Lishma, and he gives it out, Bezrat Hashem, then part of their studying of the Torah is his. God says, because you loved each other and you were willing to share, and you didn't think, wow, I worked so hard, why shouldn't he work? He should work so hard too. And then physical work, and then when he works, he will have also money. But instead of looking at it this way, but you share what you have because you remember that this money is not yours. Nothing is ours in this world. When we go out of this world, we leave everything here. All the beautiful house, the car, the money that we have in the bank, the beautiful clothing, the beautiful kitchen, everything stays here. Our beautiful library, everything stays here. Nothing, we do not take anything with us. Nothing. Only our good deeds and the commandments that we did in this world. Nothing else. We don't have anything to dress up with. And the neshama, the soul, is dressed up with all of these beautiful things that we did in this world. So this is our sachar shelanu. This is our merit in this world. That's why it's so important to run after mitzvah. You should run after mitzvah in order to do them, in order to have this beautiful clothing. Because once you do that, you not only merit yourself, you merit your children, you merit your grandchildren, and with you the whole world, the goyim and everyone. If they knew that, they would have taken all the children of Israel to the land of Israel. They would put them over there and they will see that the children of Israel will practice Judaism. Because the whole world profits from our studying the Torah, the written and the oral, and by our practicing unconditional love between each other. Because I told you, numerical value of Ahava, it's not a coincidence that God calls it Lo Ahavai, the ones that love me. Because God says you can go to the synagogue, you can practice over there davening, you can daven anywhere at home also, but if you hate your other all my children, it's you hate me. Because when someone hates your child, he does not love you. He cannot say, I love you, but I don't like your child, I don't like him. God says you have to show me that you love me by showing me that you love my children.
Okay, if somebody
again, he will. If a person hurts you, if a person, God forbid, hurts you, it's important. The question is in place. Listen, dear women, I would like to tell you, if a person, God forbid, hurts you, he is doing a bad fixing in this world. And if you did not say anything, and you were quiet and silent, if you did not embarrass him back, you're doing a wonderful fixing in this world. The points that you get in the next world are very high. The level that you get over there is very high. Everything is written because there's an eye that sees, an ear that listens, and everything is recorded and written in a book. So don't think Hashem does not see everything he sees.
Okay, I have another thing. Gilad Shalit, Bachur, Shetapsur, מה הוא עשה רע לאנשים האלה שעושים כל מיני פוליטיקה? איך הוא צריך
להגיש? אני לא אכנס לזה עכשיו.
איך הוא צריך להגיש בזה?
זה התיקון שלו. This is his speech. Look at Eliyahu Hanavi. Look at all of this. I would like to... להבדיל אלפי הבדלות. Let me say something. No, when you see... when I'll tell you... She says...
Don't go.
No, I'm not going to go into it. I would just like to tell you, when you see righteous people that are getting hurt, listen very carefully. This is from Hashem. This is a fixing. You, a person has suffering. A person has suffering. Why? There are a few reasons. A lot of reasons, but I'll give you some of them. One is, Amrim, En yesurim de lo abonot, which means if a person does a sin, God punishes him. When you do a sin, Adadad already told you once that there's Bat Kol Yotzat Mehar Choreb, which means a voice from heaven comes out from Har Chor, from the mountain of Choreb, every day, and says to the children of Israel, Oy lachem, oy labriot melbona shel Torah. It says, Oy to the children of Israel from the shame of the Torah, that you do not practice it, you do not do what I told you to do. Every day. So what happens? Can somebody over here tell me if he hears this voice? His soul hears this voice. Nobody, it seems like, yeah, no, you will tell me, but I don't hear the voice that says, Oy lachem, oy labriot melbona shel Torah. You do hear the voice, and I'll tell you how. Baal Shem Tov Zchutot Hagen Aleinu says, you hear the voice, how? If you go through the way you came in the middle of the day, or at the end of the day, when you're alone with yourself, and you said, wow. You're doing cheshbon nefesh. You're just calculating everything that you did this day, and you came to a conclusion, I did a bad thing today. Or I did a good thing today. But I feel that I heard this in this person. This thought is exactly the voice that calls us from Har Choreb, from the mountain of Choreb. This voice, when you feel that you did a bad thing and you want to do tshuva, it means that you heard the voice. Your soul heard the voice. If you did not hear, if you feel that you are righteous and you are tzaddik, and there's nothing to fix in you, and you're okay, this is how I am, and I'm excellent in this world, it means that the shells of the evil spirit are so badly around you that you cannot even with your spiritual ears and your spiritual eyes, you cannot see. What you see is only the physical world in this world. You understand? Okay, let's continue. So it says like this, I went through it, and I told you that this is 620. Let's continue. We have the seven mitzvot of Bnei Noach. Shh. We have the seventh mitzvot. Yeah, we're almost finished with our introduction. We have the seven commandments of the children of Noach. Do you see that in your booklets? The seven commandments? He gives. Ma? Ze ha-goyim, ze ma she-tzeh, ze shel-goyim. This is the seven commandments that the nations receive. In the English one, it's page three. The seven commandments of the sons of Noah. You see them?
Yes.
Page two in the Hebrew booklet and page three in the... Okay, so let's start. The first one is Ever Minachai. They are not allowed to cut a limb, a part of an animal when it's still alive and to eat it. This is Ever Minachai. Ever Shenechtaf O Nikra Mibal Chai Bodenu Chai Asur Beachila. They are not allowed, the nations, to cut a part. They don't have the kashrus that we have. They do not have chukei shchita that we have, the laws of shchita that we have. But they have this law that says, this is part of the seven laws, you'll see it in Parashat Noach, in the portion of Noach, over there God gives him, for all his children, the seven commandments of Bnei Noach. So it says here they are not allowed to take or to tear or to cut a part of a limb, or a limb from a living animal and to eat it. The second one is Birkat Hashem. They are not allowed, God forbid, to curse the name of God. They are not allowed to curse, God forbid, the name of God. Then the third one is Gezel. They are not allowed to steal. And then the fourth one is Dinim. They have to put courts in order to judge between people. They have to build courts in order to judge between people. And then the fifth one is Gilui Arayot, immoral behavior, sexual behavior. Ze Gilui Arayot, they are not allowed. And then they have the sixth one is Shfichud Damim, murder is not allowed. Those are part of the seven commandments that the nations receive. And then the seventh one, they are not allowed to worship a different god.
And they are doing it also.
I will tell you, you know what's the worship today? Wait.
No?
I would like to explain something. You know what you know what is Avodah Zarah today? What is worshipping a different god today? Worshipping money. This is Avodah Zarah. And the second one is prostitution. Running after money and running after girls or boys, men or women. Those two is Avodah Zarah Shalom. Those are the Avodah Zarah. It doesn't matter. You understand me?
Money is the first.
But those are Avodah Zarah of today. If you put money first, if you feel that this money is mine, it's mine, I have to have it. I can't give it, I won't open my hands to others.
What about the men who do both of them, Hashem Ishmor?
They have to learn, study Torah in order to help themselves to do a fixing in this world. But this is Avodah Zarah Shel Hayom. This is Avodah Zarah. They have to pay in order to survive, of course.
Yes.
But they have also to open their hands for tzedakah. Even a person that sits down on the street and begs for money, he has to give tzedakah. He has to. Ad kedei kach. Because God says, Asor te'aser bishvil shetitasher nasuni bazot. He says, God, you should give 10th of everything that you receive. Try me for this, and I will see that you will be rich, and you will see. When you open your hand, listen very carefully, when you open your hand, not 99% physically, but 99% spiritually, with your heart that you truly want to give out. It's not that you, well, I'll give because it's not nice in the synagogue, they will see me, my friends, and so for honor, so they will honor me, they will say my name. Not for that, but you gave truly because you wanted to give. You know, it depends on the percentage of how much spiritually you want to give and how much physically you can give. So it goes together. Sometimes a poor person will give less than a rich person, but his donation is with all of his heart. It's considered more in heaven. Do you understand? So the way you open your hand, it's very important also. We should never feel cheap with money because it's not ours. God says in the Navi Haggai, in the prophet Haggai, it says over there, Li hakesef v'azav, it's mine. Everything that you see in this world, the gold and the silver, it's mine. I decide on Rosh Hashanah until Yom HaKippurim what to give you. And everything that I gave you is exactly what you need to do your fixing this year. You do not need more than that. Only three things are exceptional. He says, God, if you put more money in Shabbat and my holidays and for your children to go to yeshiva, you won't lachsoch him.
Save.
You won't save money to bring him to the best yeshiva that you can. Everything that you can do, if you'll do that, I will add to your income. So you can do that, and it's true. When a person wants to do that, it's true, I can tell you, try it and you will see it's true. God adds to you, will not believe it.
Even if I pay my last money to tzedakah, and I say, what I'm doing, tomorrow what's going to happen? Tomorrow I have double and triple of
it. That, you'll see, try it and you'll see it's true. It's you can check it. So you can try and you'll see, God says, it's the only place that God says, Nasuni Bazaar, try me. God says, try me and you'll see it's true. Don't be cheap with my money, God says. It's the money that I have. I divided it between all of you. Yes?
I have a question. What if that money, the income, was not earned by the true, like how to say?
Kosher
money.
Shabbos money.
No.
Let's say Shabbos money.
For example, somebody sells drugs and that makes me from the.
That's a big problem. I know, it's a big problem. But God, this is stealing. Anyway, he's judged all over.
If somebody's stealing money, somebody has to bring to that
is it possible?
You know, the rabbis also spoke about it. And there are rabbis that say that they do not want to take money that was stolen, and there are rabbis that say they will take. I will explain to you, because we are not God and we do not know how to judge exactly in this world. We do not know what God... We do not, it's better instead of embarrassing that, because we do not really know what a person does or does not do. We do not know. But if you know, it's the rabbi who needs to decide what he does. Do you understand? God already decided. He knows. God already decides what to do with a person. He already knows. But what we do over here between ourselves, it's very delicate. Why is that? Because if God forbid a person embarrasses a person in front of other people, he does not have a part, even though he did a lot of mitzvot. He does not, because God says, my children are so precious to me, and I, God says, I myself saw to it that nothing, you know, like domem, things that don't move, things that don't have any life inside them, life that, like we know them, they don't not grow. Well, I see to that they won't be punished. For example, when Moshe Rabbeinu had the stick, and God told him to take the mateh, and he told him that you have to put the mateh on the water, but he said you will not do that, you will give your brother to do that on the Nile. And God, Moshe Rabbeinu asked his Hashem, he said, why won't I do that? He says, because the Nile helped you when you were a baby and you were in the box. The Nile helped you. So you have to have a karata tov, saying thank you, appreciating what the Nile did to you. So God says, Zedomem, I appreciate what do they, so what they do towards the human beings. So alachat kama vechama, between ourselves we have feelings. The water does not have feelings. And also earth, when God told him to Moshe Rabbeinu, take the stick and give it to Aaron and let him touch the earth, that touched the ground, and from there there was lysis. He says, you know why he told him to do that? Not Moshe Rabbeinu, because the earth covered, the ground covered the Egyptian when Moshe Rabbeinu killed him with the name of God. So he says, you cannot, you have to be thankful that he did that. So he says, Al chat kama vechama, it says, that we human beings should be very delicate with each other, should be sensitive. Like, I don't want to get hurt, so I shouldn't do bad things to others so they won't get hurt. Exactly like I don't want other people to do bad things to me. I should not do bad things to other people. That's a very, you know, a simple principle. It's very logical. That's the beginning of loving each other. You should love thy neighbor. So I would like to continue to finish this page. It's called Three Things. You have it on the third page in the English version and the second page in the Hebrew version. Three commandments that a Jew must die for instead of transgressing. He is not allowed to do them. So it says, this is the, we are finishing now the intro. It's a small, I'm giving you a small introduction. So basic things you'll know about Judaism, basic things like the laws and the Rabbanan, the Oraita, the laws of Bnei Noach. And it's written, Gilui Arayot, immoral, intimate, sexual intimate relationship. Shfichud Damim is murder. And then the third one is Avodah Zarah, worshipping another god. The first temple was ruined because the three things were practiced by the Jewish people. They worshipped another god, and because of that, they sacrificed their children, they came to murder, and they also had immoral interaction between themselves, sexual interaction. So God ruined the first temple. The second temple was ruined because of false hatred, which is equal to those three things. הבניין בית המקדש הראשון נחרב על שלוש העבירות האלה, גילוי עריות, עבודה זרה ושפיכות דמים, ובית המקדש השני נחרב על שנאת חינם, שזה מקביל. False hatred is equal to these three things, God forbid. To worshiping and false hatred. When a person hates you without any reason, you should know, you're not allowed to. First of all, God forbid, if a person hates another person, he does not harm that person. He first of all harms himself. Do you understand? He does not hurt the other person. Yes.
Is it between just Jewish people or against the other people?
All over the world. All over the world, it doesn't matter. If, for example, a nation does bad things to us, we should defend ourselves. But we shouldn't have that hate, you know, because the hate causes us bad things. in our spirit it causes. We should fight in the name of God. Once we fight in the name of God, God will help us and our soul will stay clean. Hatred is a bad thing. Do you understand? When Cain was jealous of Hebel, he came and killed him. That, and when jealousy starts, you saw Keshet. You saw, you remember the rainbow, the Keshet? Yeshki now, when jealousy starts, then came Cain's hatred, Sina. Do you understand? That's from the rainbow. We can see that over there. Because then when we have jealousy, it causes us to hate that person. And hatred is not good for us. It's not good for the soul. We need positive things for the soul. So it only hurts us eventually. I can understand that other nations, listen, dear women, I can understand that other nations hate us. You know, but the cause of this hatred, the cause of it, the essence of this hatred, eventually, is the Jewish people. You will ask me why. I'll explain to you. When we do not do, when we do not do what Hashem wants us to do, and we try to mingle with the goyim, with the nations, and we try to imitate what they do, we try lechakot, imitate means lechakot otam, we try to lechakot et goyim, in their clothing, in the way they work, in the way they don't have Shabbat, they do not have to keep Shabbat. We saw only the seven commandments they have. It's not part of their commandments. The tattoos and everything. Listen, dear women, we cause only pain to ourselves. God says, if you do not remember me, I will cause the nations to go against you. We say that twice a day in Shema Israel. If you listen, because you signed a treaty with me, you cannot go out. This is Morasha. It's not Yerusha, it's Morasha. I gave it out to you. The Torah is between us all the time. It's a treaty. We cannot go back and say, no, I'm not part of the children. You cannot do that. You will be always, and it's a privilege to be a Jew. Because your soul comes from a very high place. It's like we are the daughters of a king, and we are the sons of a king. Can you think about it? The king Elizabeth, or you can see other kings and queens. The queens, so their children, they have responsibility. They cannot behave like ordinary people because they were chosen out of those people. Hashem chose us. We shouldn't know how to keep it. It's a very precious diamond, this way that He chose us. It's not something that we can throw away, God forbid. It's the essence of us. If we won't do that, we will be punished. God says that. And everything that He writes in His Torah is the truth. Everything that is written here is the truth. And every soul knows that, even the goyim, even the nations. In their essence, they feel that this is the truth. Because the soul knows the truth. It's only the physical body that is over the soul that does not let us see the truth because of the evil spirit, because of our choices. Otherwise, we'll know the truth. If you look with the spiritual eyes, not the physical eyes, because I told you the eye is holy. What we see with our eyes is very holy. I would like to continue, dear women. Let's go to the next page. I think it's the fourth. Huh? Ah, Masha Lagid al Chaye Sara. Okay, if we spoke about holy, but I would like Rak Masha Netilat Yadayim. I will say Chaye Sara, but I need the Netilat Yadayim of the morning at least. You will start the Birkot HaShachar when we wake up in the morning. יש כלי לנטילה, נכון? כן. לא, לא, שבי, שבי, אני... תודה. I would like to start only at least this, and I will give you the next lesson, we'll continue. But bring the booklets with you, it's very important. You'll see, you'll enjoy the booklets. Once you'll understand what's inside it, you will see, you'll enjoy it. בלי נדר. בעזרת השם. So first, when a person comes...
Okay,
I didn't explain the love, but listen, if you look at numerical value, the Aleph is 1, the He is 5, the Bet is 2, and the other He is 5. How much is it together? 13. So when one person loves another person, it's 13 plus 13, it's the name of God. They practice the name of God. 13 is also 1. אחד. 13, שמע ישראל, השם אלוקינו, השם אחד. 13 is אחד. Because Aleph is 1, Chet is 8, and Dalet is 4. Together it's 13. אחד, the name of God. אחד includes the whole tribes of Israel. Echad, the word Echad. So this 13 of Abba, you know how much merit we have from this, from just loving each other? It doesn't cost any money. You know, it doesn't cost us to say nice things to each other. It doesn't cost money. You know, it doesn't cost anything. Okay, let's look over here, dear women. Echad is also all the tribes because Aleph of Echad is the name of God. I told you this is a Yudis 10. And another yud is another 10, and the vav is 6, together it's 26 from echad. Then we have the chet, and we have the dalet. I told you the chet is the 8 children of our mothers, Rachel and Leah. Leah had 6 sons, and Rachel had 2 sons, together it's 8. Chet is 8. Dalet is 4, the 4 sons that Bilhah and Zilpah had. Together it's 12, the 12 tribes. So 13 is also Echad. When we add 13 and 13, we have 26 of the name of God. So once we love each other unconditionally, we practice, we complete the name of God. There's no ki yadel kesya milchama l'Hashem ba'amalek midor dor. We complete the yud kei vav kei by loving, just loving each other. It doesn't cost us anything, just to be nice to each other.
I love everybody.
Baruch Hashem, and we love you back. Baruch Hashem. So, I will tell you, remind me, I will tell you something. We said about Shema Yisrael. It's written in Chayei Sarah that Sarah, you know, Chayei Sarah, the life of Sarah, and we're talking about at the beginning of the parasha about the death of Sarah. But righteous people, their merit is bigger when they die. It's like righteous people, when they die, they are living in this world because the merit lives after them. All the scholars that they had, all the people that they helped to do tshuva, all of them is their merit. All the good deeds and everything that they did in this world, the children that will practice Torah and cause other people to practice Torah. It's like this, it's spread, it's all over. This is their big merit. But it says, imeta bekiryat arba. So it says Kiryat Arba is a place, you know, Hebron, Kiryat Arba. But it says, Maze Kiryat Arba, it says, don't read Kiryat Arba, read it Kiryat Arba, to read Arba. Kiryat Arba. Instead say Kiryat Arba. Kiryat Arba, which means to read. To read Arba. What is the Arba? The Arba is, Shema, she passed away with the words of Hashem on her mouth. How? Shema Yisrael, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad. That's how she passed away. She said, when she was saying Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad, she passed away. Sarai Menu. In this chapter, you will see also in this chapter how Eliezer, Eved Avraham, Eliezer, which was the slave of Avraham, he went to find a wife. He went to find a wife for the son of Avraham, for Yitzchak. And once before he goes, he says to Avraham Avinu, you know, maybe she won't want to go with me. Maybe she won't want. And he says, Ulai, it's written in the Ketuvim, Ulai, it's written, Ulai. Ulai, and it's with kibbutz. It's written with kibbutz, Ulai. So the Midrash says, don't read it Ulai, maybe she won't. He says, Elai, to me. Which means that Eliezer, Eved Avraham, he had a daughter, beautiful daughter. And he worked and he became Jewish. He was Knaani. He became Jewish and he wanted his daughter so much to get married to Yitzchak. So he tries to hint to Avraham Avinu. He says, Ulai, which means Elai, I want my daughter to marry your son. And you know how righteous I am. You see how much I love Hashem. And you know that Eliezer is one of the 10 people that went alive to the next world. Yeah. He did not die. He wasn't buried. He was Knaani and he went up to heaven alive. I'll explain why, but listen very carefully. So, you know what Avraham Avinu told him? Avraham said, no, you can't. Your daughter cannot marry my son. Because you are Arur, you are cursed. ארור כנען, נוח סד, ארור כנען, עבד עבדים יהיה לאחר. כנען is cursed, he's going to be a slave to his brothers. And this happens when a righteous person says something. You saw that even the people from Africa, the black people became slaves. This is the curse of Noah. כנען, הוא אמר ארור כנען, עבד עבדים יהיה לאחר. נוח was a righteous person, צדיק יסוד עולם. That's why all of his blessings came true and all of his curses came true. And we can see it until today. Everything is the same. All the things that is written in the Torah, is you can see them today. So he says, you are cursed, you cannot marry my daughter. I am blessed. Because Malki Tzedek, Melech Shalem, when he came to greet Avraham Avinu, he went out to greet Avraham Avinu when he came. You remember, Avraham Avinu had a war with the four kings in order to save Lot, his nephew. So when he came back, Melchizedek Melech Shalem went out in order to greet him with bread and wine. And then he says, Baruch Avraham Le'el Elyon. So Avraham says, I am blessed and you are cursed. We cannot get married. Now, tell me, if a person tells you something like that, would you go and do what he asks you to do? Would you go after he embarrasses you like this and says something that you feel so bad with yourself, that you are cursed? It's an insult. It's like you throw, you know, you take a bucket of bad water and throw it on a person. You know, of water that are not clean. And look, when Eliezer comes to Laban ve-Betuel, and you know, Laban ve-Betuel, ha-Arami, Ketuv, Laban, he comes to Laban.
How such a righteous person can say something?
It's okay, you'll see. I'll explain.
Avraham לא יכול לברך אותו?
לא.
אז איך זה במואבים ומואבית זה כן?
God forgive that?
זה לא כנעני. I would like to tell you something. Wait. He became Jewish. But still, he could not marry his son Yitzchak because from Yitzchak, all the Jewish nation will go out. You understand? Why did Leah did not marry Esav? She could have made him righteous. She was a righteous woman. He would have made tshuva. But why? Because she wanted to be part of the children of Israel. If she married Esav, she won't be part of the children of Israel. Her children won't be part of the chosen people. Do you understand? That's why she wanted Yaakov.
You just said before, when those people, they become religious.
Kiurim, no, Kiurim.
Yeah, they double get the...
He would do tshuva, but he won't be yet part of the children of Israel. Ishmael did tshuva. Ishmael did tshuva in front of Hashem. And we know that once they came, once they went and buried Abraham Avinu, we know by the writing that Ishmael did tshuva in front of Hashem. But still, he's not part of the children of Israel. Do you understand?
He's not part.
Ger tzedek הוא לגמרי יהודי, רק אין לו עבר יהודי. For example, if he comes with the ביקורים to בית המקדש, he cannot say the whole מקרא ביקורים, he cannot read it from the Torah, because he cannot say that Hashem took his father and mother from Egypt, you understand, did Exodus for them, because he doesn't have that past. But still, he's part of the children of Israel. And don't forget that there was not conversion before that. And I would like to continue and tell you, where did we stop now? I would like to continue and tell you about Eliezer. So when he went to Laban and Betuel, and he says over there to Laban and Betuel, he says to them, you know, Betuel was the father of Rivka, and Laban was her brother. So he says, Ve'avo hayom ve'avo hayom el ha'ayin. It's written in the parasha, you'll see. And he says to them, now I came over here. Today I came. One day it took me. It takes 17 days to go from Kiryat Arba to go to Haran. 17 days. It means that the road jumped for him. Haaretz katsalot, the pitzat derech. If he wasn't righteous with his thoughts towards Avraham Avinu, this miracle wouldn't happen for him. It means that the soul, look, everybody can use the name of Kvitzat HaDerech of Hashem. But it won't happen to us. You know why? Because we are captured in this physical body, we are not so pure that the body will become also like the soul. only pure people, their body becomes like the soul, spiritual. So they can go from place to place. For example, Arav Shalom Shabazi, he was in Yemen. He used to study Torah in Sfat and in Jerusalem. But he was in Yemen. He was never in Jerusalem. He was never in the land of Israel. But he could make his body spiritual and go to those yeshivas and learn there. And also the Arizal used to study, he used to concentrate, make himself spiritual and study with the yeshivot in heaven. And know a lot of secrets from the Torah. So those are things for very righteous people that they are not captured in this physical body. Do you understand? Eliezer was the same. Otherwise, it wouldn't jump the road instead of 17 days that he had to walk until he comes to ride until he comes to Haran. Instead of 17 days, he came in one day. How do we know that? By the treaty that was signed. You know, Abraham Avinu signed that he gives all his promising and possessions to Yitzchak. He signed a paper. The date was the same day. And then all of the fruits that he brought, Migdanot, that he brought from the land of, from Kiryat Arba, from there, everything that he brought was fresh like it was just picked up today. Just they took it out today. It wasn't spoiled. It was fresh, everything. So they knew that it was truly he came today. So then, Ken.
So whoever can let the share of the Shab Tzadik?
No, מי שצדיק זה מה שהקדוש ברוך הוא חושב צדיק. אז אנחנו קוראים להם צדיקים, אבל אני אגיד לך את האמת, מי שבאמת צדיק זה הקדוש ברוך הוא קובע מי צדיק. בוחן ליבות וכליות. We know that there are righteous rabbis today. We go to them, and it's good to them to make it, to go to a rabbi to ask him questions that he can help you. But the true tzaddik is in the eyes of God. Do you understand? Because we do not have the ability even to count. But we can know who is more righteous than us. Do you understand? We know who is more righteous than us because we can feel and we can see. You see, we feel the essence, the energy from the person. So you can know, and you see how he practices the Torah. So you know who is more righteous than us. Is it? Definitely. So I would like to show you how Eliezer, Eved Avram, overcame his pride, his jealousy, his anger, all of those bad feelings that are caused because Avram Avinu told him that his Arur is cursed and his Baruch is blessed. And he took all of these and put it aside and understood that what Avram says is from Hashem, that it's not supposed to be that his daughter will marry his son. It's from Hashem. Avram Avinu did not take anything out of his mouth that did not come from Hashem. So he understood that, and he overcame all of this, you know, the games of the evil spirit to make him to think about his pride, you know what I mean, to be angry with Avram Avinu. And instead of that, he did everything with all of his heart in order to go towards Hashem and to do everything that he needed. And I told you that Rivka fell from the camel, it says, and because of that, she didn't have the sign of being a virgin. So Yitzchak thought maybe Eliezer touched her. So God asked the angel, it says in the Midrash, that God spoke to the angels and said, we know that Eliezer is very righteous. He did not touch her, we know that. So what shall we do that everybody will know that Eliezer, Eved Avraham, was very righteous? He took him to heaven with his body. He did not die. You know, it's a big privilege. Like Eliyahu HaNavi did, Nalavdil Alfei Abdalot, but like Eliyahu HaNavi went to heaven with his, and Serach Bat Asher, and also Batya Bat Paro, the daughter of Paro Batya, that to convert it to Judaism. She also went to heaven without dying. So, okay, the one that raised Moshe Rabbeinu. Now, at least let's do the Netila, okay? Look, dear women. Look at the page. I think it's the fourth page in the English one. Okay, the fourth page in the English booklet and the third page. The third page, concentrate, in the Hebrew booklet. And it starts, when a person wakes up in the morning, he should raise a little bit his head, open his hands and say, Modeh ani lefanecha. I thank you, Hashem, that you brought back my soul into my body. You have to say that so you will start the day, It says, the Baal Shem Tov says, so you can start the day with the name of God in your mouth, that all of your thoughts will be with Hashem. And then you have to do Netilat Yadayim. Mm-hmm. At least this I will give you now. We'll say that again next lesson. You take, and it's very important how you do the Netilat Yadayim. The half part of our body towards the right side of our body is kindness, is chesed. The left side is dinim, is judgment. We want all the judgments that were decided that night for us this day to be slaves to kindness, that we won't have judgment over us. What do? We wake up. I'll tell you what I do. I put a bucket, kilu zekatan kara, and I put this inside with water. I cover it with a towel. And in the morning, after I say mode, I wake up, I put it on a chair, and then I hold the bucket with, I hold this, the kli. It's very important, the kli, with my right hand. I raise my right hand like this, and then I don't pour the water. Then I take it to the left hand, and then I start 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And why it's important, and then I take this water and I throw it into the toilet, okay? Because it's not pure, this water. Mm-hmm. It's very important. Once I raise my right hand, this is the hand of kindness, chesed, the kindness. I move it to the left, this is judgment. Now I want the judgments to be slaves to the kindness. So that's why I take the judgment hand and pour the water on the right hand, on chesed. So I will have chesed, kindness, the whole day. It's very important. It's not the same way we do the netilah before we eat.
No,
it's not the same. But it's very important. Then we do it vice versa on both sides. When we finish, we throw the water. If we can.
אסור לעשות הרבה צעדות, זה רחוק ממך,
כאילו אסור לעבור 400, you're not allowed to have a few feet to walk, 400 זה כאילו זה המה, אז 400 אסור לעבור, בלי נטילת ידיים, and why? There are a few reasons, I wrote it over here, I'll explain to you why. You raise your hand, after the water is on your hand, you raise your hands towards your face, and then you wipe your hands and throw it. Now, if you have to go to the toilet, you do not say the blessing. You don't say the blessing of Netilat Yadayim. Because you cannot mention the name of God if your face is not clean. You understand? If you need to go to the toilet, you cannot say the name of God. So you do the Netila, then you go wash yourself, do everything. Then you can do the Netila, and then say Birkot HaShachar. And say, do Netila by the sink. In the kitchen and say the Al Netilat Yadayim, and then you say Birkot HaShachar. Do you understand? Because you have to be clean. You can't go in front of the king not clean. You can't mention the king's name.
That already different Netilah.
כן, אבל אז את אומרת הברכה של נטילת, כי לפני זה, you can't, if you have to go to the toilet, you cannot mention the name of God.
Okay?
It depends how many times you were, how long you slept. Do you understand? If it's after midnight you slept, okay, not before, but if you slept after midnight, if you slept for 2 hours, it's a different, for those who have diabetes and wake up all the time, they are not, you can ask a rabbi also, but they don't have to do the netilah all the time because it's like they did not sleep. Do you understand? If you wake up every hour, every 2 hours, you have to have a period of at least 2.5 hours, 3 hours. Then it's considered as a sleep because it says that when we sleep, it's 1/60 of a day of death. Echad meshishim mita, which means part of your soul goes up and gives judgment over there, over all the things that you did the whole day. And when it comes back, you're impure. You have to, and the impurity stays over here, in between your fingers. That's why you have to do netilah. You're not allowed to touch yourself. Not your eyes, nothing. First do the netilah.
Okay.
תראי, אם אין ברירה, אז עשית זה במקלחת, אבל עדיף שזה לא יהיה במקלחת. עדיף שזה יהיה בחוץ, לא ליד השירותים. לא ליד השירותים. אז לכן אני לוקחת, זה לא קשה. לוקחים כלי ושמים את זה עם מים, שמים מגבת מלמעלה, וזה עדיף ככה. רק אם ממש, מה?
Also, netilat yadayim, you have to say after the teeth brush, when you brush teeth.
Why? You do not say after you brush your teeth. No, you, no, no. You do netila
without... Rabbi, you have to say after, not before.
I understand what you're saying. You have to clean yourself. It means that you have to brush your teeth. You have to, yes, your face, of course. Then you can say the bracha with the name of God. I did not understand you at first. But of course, you have to clean yourself. Dear women, with this we start the day. We start by taking... And the reasons, I wrote it in the booklet. There are a few reasons. It says first, Chazal say that our hands are busy at night and they may be touch private places. That's why we have to do Netilat Yadayim. This is one reason. Then I told you that it's 1/60th of death, because the soul goes out and only part of the soul stays to give Din B'Cheshbon. And the third thing, it says that there's an evil spirit that is around us in the morning when we wake up. And King Solomon, he's the one that said how to do the Netilat Yadayim, how to practice Netilat Yadayim. It's because of King Solomon, because he saw the evil, he used to see demons and bad spirits. So he saw the evil, when he woke up, he saw the evil spirit, and he wanted to get rid of her. He blessed, he said a lot of things, but nothing helped. He tried to wash his hands, nothing helped. The only thing that helped, he took a kli, natla in Aramit, it's called natla, natla in Aramit. Means in Aramaic means kli, you know kli. So okay, natla is kli in Aramaic. It means this is the kli. So he took one and he started doing the Netilat Yadayim, and only then the spirit went away. We do not see spirits. Most of us do not see the bad, the evil things that are around, and the good things we do not see. The spiritual world that is around us, we do not see it. But King Solomon saw it, and then from there he said we have to do Netilat Yadayim, and this is the way we do that. In order that the judgment will be slaves for the kindness.
And you pick it up in the right hand, you give it to the left,
כן,
and you start
כן,
going
לך,
on the right.
It's written also in the booklet. Exactly how to do that. I wrote it down. And you have the reasons also.
Were the children also fix them in the room?
את יכולה לשים לילדים, כן, למה לא? וללמד אותם, it's important to teach the children, because the way they are taught, this is what they are going to practice after them. I would like to tell you, I know it's late, dear women, I would like to bless, we'll continue next week. I would like to bless all of you that Mashiach will come b'mera b'yameinu, amen. Shehegeh mevaser Eliyahu Nabi Eliyahu, bishvili Eliyahu b'di b'mera b'yameinu, Shech ben David, Eliyahu Nabi Zachur Latov, Yolah Niparet, Adam Nichaberot, Bibar Alakha Yachid, Barabim Alakha Kerabim. God bless you. Bring the booklets, the English and the Hebrew ones.